Let's talk CORS, also known as cross-origin resource sharing. CORS, as the name suggests, is a way that we can share different resources and data between endpoints and other origins. An origin could be an endpoint, an API, or two applications running in the browser talking to each other. When you use CORS, there's many things you need to look out for. So, as you know, with great power comes great responsibility, and that's what we're going to take a look at today. What we're going to do here is we're going to create a server that's going to emulate a bank application, or imagine we're creating the backend for some larger bank where we can access some data about our user and such. And this is used totally legitimately on the side. So let's start by setting up this so-called server, and I'm going to call this bank.js. Will just be used nodes built-in web server, and to import that we just use require, not that one, HTTP, like so. Now we have the HTTP server, and that's basically it. We can then say create server, and within here we can specify what requests we want to accept. So we're going to create an arrowhead function that takes two arguments, the request and then the response that we can pass the user, like so. And we're going to ask to listen to port 8080. That's a pretty default development server, at least in many cases. So first of all, I'm thinking we need a place where we can check our account name. And in this case, I'm just going to go with the default user called Jensen. Assume he's already logged in, and let's see what happens. All right, so let's first of all say the request URL is equal to account. Then we want to give some information back about the user, but we also want to take the request method into account. So we're going to say that it's only going to respond to this part if it's going to account and the method is get. And I'll show you in a second what this means. All right, so what we're going to do next is we're going to use the response up here, and then we'll say right head, where we can give some metadata information about the response that we want to send back to the user. So we'll give it a status code 200, which means okay. Then we'll add some headers. In this case, I'm going to use content type text slash JSON, like so. Perfect. And then we just want to write some data for this. I'm going to end the response, and then we just need to tell it to end it with what. And actually, in this case, we're going to use json.stringify, because we can't just give it an object out in the browser. So in here, we have some information about the user. So like I said earlier, let's assume we're already logged in. That means we're logged in as this guy called Jens. So that could be first name Jens, last name Jensen. And then maybe the site or the API should also have some information about the user. So we'll have an email int@example.org, and then we'll also create a social security number. And according to the Danish standard, we have six numbers right here, and then another four right here. This is a typical Danish social security number. Well, of course, not looking exactly like this, but yeah, you get the point. And we'll tell it to return, so we're not doing anything else. Right, let's see what happens when we boot this up. So I'm just gonna run this real quick over here. I can just start it up. And if you're wondering why I can do this, actually, let's go through that real quick. I'm gonna delete this folder right now, and you'll see that this is now gone. And this is what you should be presented with when you try this out the first time. So when you do this, or when you're working in Visual Studio Code, you should be working with that within a folder, because then you can click on this button right here, create it, launch the JSON file, and we'll tell it to use Node.js. Here we go. And this creates a file up in the .vs code directory. And that's why we need to open a folder from the beginning, because then it knows where to put this file. So right here, I'm gonna change this so it doesn't always open bank, but just to file. And what this means is that whatever file I have open, it'll try to launch using Node. So So when I press F5 now, it has booted up the server. So let's see what happens. All right, so I've gone into google.dk in Chrome, and we're gonna go into the developer tools now. So within here, I'm gonna use the fetch method, and we're gonna ask it to fetch from localhost port 8080, because that's what we specified over here. Then we need to enter the URL we're looking for, /account. We don't need two of these. And then since this is a promise, we need to give it a response. At the response, if it's JSON, then we can decode it, but that also gives us a promise back, so we need to use then again to extract it. Anyway, I'm gonna press enter now, and we should be able to access our endpoint or our bank, right? No. So it says that Google, since we're on Google right now, the access to fetch localhost account from origin google.com has been blocked by CORS. So it's saying that Google is not allowed to access this localhost. But let's imagine that this is a sub domain for a bank, and we just need to legitimately need to access this account data to show something for the user. Well, what we can do here is we can add another header to the response. We'll say access control allow origin. And then we can specify that we allow all our origins. We're going to restart by clicking up here. We're good. And I'm going to send the request again. Look what happens. First name, Jens. Last name, Jensen. Email. And here's everything that we need to know about the user. And now if this was some sort of app, then we could populate it with the data or show something. This is really cool, a way we can easily communicate back and forth with an API in the browser. Let's see how this could go wrong though. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna create a new file over here. We'll call it malicious site.html, like so. We'll create an HTML tag ahead, and we'll call this, this is a totally legal site. And let's create a body tag. Expand it, and let's just say that we want to sign up for my awesome newsletter below. And we'll create a form. The form has an input with an email, placeholder, email at email.com, and then a way to submit this. Let's verify that this is working by opening it in live server. Like so, we'll see it's now up and running. So let's see this, let's say that this is a malicious site. Now that we have opened up access for basically everyone onto this domain, then if the malicious site knew this, then we could create a script tag down here. And we can take the code we wrote before up here, take this, paste it in here, localhost account, and we could then do uploading data to malicious server, like so. And let's reload this page over here. We need to just json.stringify this, since this is an actual object. And there we go. So let's just say you got this page from Facebook somewhere, and you just want to sign up to some newsletter about some interesting blog or whatever it might be. Well, if this blog, that is indeed malicious, knew that, okay, there's a chance this user that visits me is also a user of bank, this bank that we have here, well, then I'm gonna go ahead and send a request when the user goes onto the site to fetch some of the information. And now this malicious site has just fetched our real name, our email, and our social security number. This is a huge risk that we don't want to deal with. This is why CORS and using it responsibly is so important when we're developing, because we need to control every part of what applications are allowed to access our data. Full disclaimer, in reality, in order for the session, for example, the user that's logged in, to be passed using a fetch from a CORS origin, the host would have to also specify access control allow credentials to be true within the header. In this case, we're going to omit this for simplicity's sake, but it's just to show that if you really wanted to go this way, that header would also have to be set on the site. Anyway, let's proceed. Let's imagine that we change the bank application over here. Instead of saying this, we'd say if request URL equals count change password. And you may already have an idea where this is going. And I'm just going to copy this right here. So, and we'll give it a status 200 and password or message password changed. Well, imagine that this endpoint was exposed from the bank. Well, if you go into the malicious side, it could instead now say, okay, well, in case the user has an active session on the other side, then we could say change password, like so. We need to change this to a post request. And so, and let's see if that works. It does not. Okay, let's see what's happening. It's still running. Okay, so of course I need to reload this. So now it's been reloaded. And try again. Changing user password. So in the background, at this point, this malicious site has just changed our password on the bank in question. Of course, this doesn't really happen in reality because you still need some verification. That's why it may ask you about some other information if you need to change the password, such as what is the current password. But if you imagine this, then there's a lot of places where this could become troublesome. So this is why we use CORS. And just to finalize things, I've created this little sequence diagram that also showcases why this is so important. So let's take a look real quick. So in this case, we're the user. We go onto the malicious site that we just created over here, and this hector.js loads. In this case, that's our script tag down here. That could have been anything. Okay, so at this point, the hector.js, it sends a request to account info to this bank, and that's what we're seeing down here. It's also sending a request to the bank. And the bank then sends the data back. As we saw before, when I did this, then we were able to get the information about the user, which we should not have been able to. And then the user can use that information to their own desire or whatever they want to do. So in order to mitigate this, we need to, of course, get it, of course. We need to change this back or simply just remove it or be more strict about what domains are allowed to access it. I'm going to restart now, and what we'll see now, I'm going to refresh, and tries to resend the back or the response back to the script over here using the fetch. But the browser right away in this instance instead says, oh no, you know what? You're not allowed to access this information. And then it terminates. That's it. You're not allowed to do anything else with this. So it's worth noting that this is happening in the browser. So if you're doing this from a server side or something, CORS is not really an issue at the same. It's not really an issue. Yeah. Anyway, thank you for watching. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask in the comment section, or yeah, just let me know. Thank you.